Good morning, students. Today's topic of discussion is AC inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers. This is a very important topic and it is often asked in the question paper. And it is also very easy if you listen to me very carefully. So let us begin the session. So today we are going to learn about the renin, angiotensin or aldosterone system as an introduction to this topic. Then we shall be looking into the main parts of this today's session, that is pharmacology of AC inhibitors in terms of its mechanism of action, actions, uses and ADR. Then we shall look into the next class of drugs, that is angiotensin receptor blockers, again in terms of its mechanism of action, actions, uses and ADR. So first we will discuss the RAS pathway. This you may have already learned in your first year classes. So this is only a recap. So renin, angiotensin, aldosterone pathway. So this is a system which is involved in the regulation of electrolyte balance, blood volume and blood pressure in the body. So once again, this is a system which is involved in the regulation of electrolyte balance, blood volume and blood pressure in the body. So mainly we'll be concentrating on the regulation of the blood pressure. So this is the flowchart of the renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system. So in this one, I'm showing the stimulus, like which is the starting area for this pathway, and then the complete pathway is being shown. So I'll be describing it step by step, and then we'll come back to this diagram again. So the step one, so the starting point is the synthesis of renin. The renin is synthesized from the juxtaglomerular cells of kidney under the different stimuli. And what are these stimuli? This can be sodium chloride loss because of any reason, fall in blood volume, fall in BP, or renal ischemia. So any of these four factors can stimulate the synthesis of renin from the juxtaglomerular cells of the kidney. So this is what you are seeing here. See, or any of these four factors, it can cause the release of renin from the juxtaglomerular cells of the kidney. So you can see where the renin is now acting. So the renin will act on the angiotensinogen and convert it into angiotensin 1. Angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. Then angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2. It is abbreviated as ANG2. Just look at this. This is a very important compound, angiotensin 2. By which enzyme? By angiotensin converting enzyme, abbreviated as ACE. So this angiotensin converting enzyme has got another name. It is also called as kininase 2. Because this enzyme is also involved in the degradation of bradykinin. So it is this enzyme converts the angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. The same enzyme can be involved in the degradation of bradykinin. So it has got the other name, kininase 2. Now, so the angiotensin 2 that is formed, it will be exerting its effects by acting on receptors called as the AT1 receptors. AT1 receptors. So all the effects that we are expecting from the RAS system is exerted through angiotensin 2. So this angiotensin 2 is important. And then how it is formed? It is formed from angiotensin 1 by which enzyme? By angiotensin converting enzyme. Now, after it, the angiotensin 2 exerts its effects by acting on the AT1 receptors, it is metabolized to less potent angiotensin 3 and 4. And these are broken into inactive fragments by angiotensinases. So mainly this area, that is the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 by the ACE enzyme is important for this chapter. And also the fact that angiotensin is acting or exerting its effects by acting on the AT1 receptors. So you can see this again, the figure is there. The renin is acting on angiotensinogen to convert it into angiotensin 1. then the important step, that is the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2 by the ACE enzyme, otherwise called as kininase 2. Then angiotensin 2 is exerting its effects through the receptors. And what are the effects we will be seeing later on in the next slide. And again, after it exerts its effect, it is converted into 3 and 4 and inactive fragments. This area is relatively less important. You have to mainly concentrate on this particular area. Then we will be seeing the effects of angiotensin 2. What are the effects of angiotensin 2? So the effects of angiotensin 2 on the CVS. So it is causing vasoconstriction and it will increase the blood pressure. Then it can also be involved in cardiac and vascular hypertrophy and remodeling. It's a chronic effect. So this is not a very favorable effect. That is, the remodeling is not a good effect. Okay. So then it is acting on the adrenal cortex to increase the synthesis and release of aldosterone from the adrenal glands. So already you people must be knowing that aldosterone acts on the kidney and promotes salt and water reabsorption. So it is increasing the blood volume. It can have a direct effect on the kidney and again cause an increase on the in the salt and water reabsorption and thus increasing the blood volume. So it is increasing the blood volume by two methods. That is, one is a direct effect on the kidney by acting on the proximal tubule, and the other is an indirect effect that it is causing through increasing the release of aldosterone. So you can see here that it is causing an increase in the blood pressure by vasoconstriction, increasing blood volume by promoting salt and water reabsorption by its direct effect on the kidney and an indirect effect through aldosterone. So what happens? So initially we had seen that the RAS pathway had come into action when there was a fall in the sodium chloride, or there was a fall in the BP, or there was a fall in the blood volume. Now, because the angiotensin 2 is produced, now all those that is being rectified. That is, there is an increase in the blood volume, there is an increase in the blood pressure. So this is the way the body regulates the blood pressure and the blood volume and even the electrolyte balance by producing angiotensin 2 whenever these parameters fall. So these actions of angiotensin is very important, that is increase vasoconstriction and increase in BP and increase in the blood volume by direct effect and indirect effect. And also you have to remember the chronic effects of angiotensin 2, that is the cardiac and vascular hypertrophy and remodeling. But this is very important because when we are going to study about the drugs, you will see that these actions will be antagonized. So here itself, you should remember these actions of angiotensin 2. Now we'll look at the drugs that are inhibiting the RAS, that is in this pathway. So we are mainly concentrating on two drugs, that is ACE inhibitors, the drugs which are inhibiting the ACE enzyme. So whenever that ACE enzyme is inhibited, what will happen? It will prevent the conversion of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So what will happen? Angiotensin 2 will not be produced. Next one is angiotensin receptor blockers. They will block the receptors through which the angiotensin 2 acts. That is, they are going to block the AT1 receptors. So there are other drugs also which inhibit the other areas of this pathway. We are not looking into that. You have to only remember these two classes of drugs, that is ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers. So at this point, you should be very clear that ACE inhibitors are preventing the production of angiotensin 2 itself by inhibiting the enzyme which is involved in its synthesis. Whereas ARBs, they are not interfering with the production. What are they interfering with? They are blocking with the receptors through which the angiotensin 2 acts. So all the actions, the complete actions of angiotensin 2 is being blocked by ARBs. This is because, see, there can be other methods or other pathways also by which angiotensin 2 can be formed other than the ACE involving pathway. So if ACE inhibitors, they will block the AC enzyme. So there can be other pathways through which the angiotensin 2 can be formed, and they can still be acting on the receptors and producing the effect. So whereas if the receptors are blocked, as in the case of ARBs, whichever pathway is involved in the production of angiotensin 2, and it will not be able to act because the receptor through which it is acting itself is blocked. So you will see that there is complete inhibition of angiotensin 2 in the case of ARBs as compared to ACE inhibitors. So first we will begin with the discussion on ACE inhibitors. So you always get a short note on ACE inhibitors. So whenever you are writing about the ACE inhibitors, you should write the short note under the following headings. That is examples, then mechanism of action, actions, uses, and ADR. And if you want to make your answers better, you can even quote some individual ACE inhibitors and their special features. But the initial common things that we are going to discuss for all the ACE inhibitors should be there in your note. So the first drug, that is captopril, it is considered as the prototype drug of ACE inhibitors, and it came into the market in 1977. The others are enalapril, lisinopril, perindopril, ramipril, and so on. So I've quoted many examples. At least you should remember enalapril, lisinopril, perindopril, and ramipril. Now, what is the mechanism of action? The mechanism is very clear to you now that it is inhibiting the action of the ACE enzyme. So what happens when the ACE is inhibited? There will not be any production of angiotensin 2. Okay, this is already clear to you from the pathway that we have discussed. So once the angiotensin 2 is decreased or the production is inhibited, what can happen? All the actions that we have studied as the angiotensin 2 actions, we have to antagonize that. Okay, so there won't be any vasoconstriction. So there won't be any, there is a dilatation. You can say there's a dilatation of arterioles. There is decreased aldosterone production, decreased sodium and water retention, and there is a decrease in the BP. Because of this, there's a decrease in the BP. We had learned, no, that vasoconstriction can occur and increase in BP. So that is not occurring here. So no vasoconstriction, and there is in fact a dilatation of the arterioles, which is causing a decrease in the BP. There is decreased aldosterone production, which is again causing decrease in the sodium and water retention, and which is again in turn leading to decrease in the BP. It will also decrease the degradation of bradykinin. So what will happen? Bradykinin will accumulate. And this bradykinin also adds to the vasodilatation and fall in BP. It is having a beneficial effect. That is, it is reversing the cardiac and vascular hypertrophy and remodeling. So I told you this hypertrophy of the cardiac muscle is not a favorable thing. So which is caused by the angiotensin 2. Now these drugs, ACE inhibitors, they are having the ability to reverse the cardiac and vascular hypertrophy and remodeling, which is a good thing. So ACE inhibitors, the uses of ACE inhibitors, you will remember hypertension. So already you must be knowing why, because it is decreasing the blood pressure. It is useful in congestive heart failure because it can reverse the cardiac remodeling. It is also useful in myocardial infarction. It is used for prophylaxis in high cardiovascular risk subjects. Used for two non-cardiac conditions, diabetic nephropathy, scleroderma crisis. So you just remember there are four cardiac conditions for which ACE inhibitors are used: hypertension, congestive heart failure, myocardial infarction, and prophylaxis in high cardiovascular risk subjects. No, two non-cardiac conditions that you will write is diabetic nephropathy and scleroderma crisis. Now, the adverse drug reactions of ACE inhibitors, again, very, very important. It should be there in your answers. Hypotension, see, because it is causing a fall in the BP. Sometimes the BP can fall below the normal level, and it can lead to hypotension. And usually it is associated with the first few doses. That's why it is also called as the first dose hypotension. Then next one is hyperkalemia. Third one is cuff, and it is, there is a special characteristic to the cuff, and it is called as the BRCA cuff. And this is mainly occurring because it of the inhibition of bradykinin degradation. So bradykinin is one substance which is involved in the generation of cuff. So when bradykinin is accumulating, it can lead to cuff. So cuff is one of the notorious adverse effects which is seen with the use of ACE inhibitors. The others are rashes, urticaria, angioedema, then dysgeusia. Dysgeusia is alteration in the taste sensation. It should not be given in pregnancy because it is teratogenic. Okay. Then others, less common adverse effects are headache, nausea, bowel upset, proteinuria, and acute renal failure. Okay, so these areas you can remember with the help of this acronym, that is captopril. You can see cuff, angioedema, proteinuria, taste sensation, otherwise called as dysgeusia, and others like headache, dizziness, P, potassium levels are high, that is hyperkalemia, then R, rashes, I is itching, urticaria, and L is low BP or hypotension. So if you cannot remember the previous slide, you can use this acronym to remember the adverse effects of ACE inhibitors. Now we look into the some of the individual ACE inhibitors. We'll be discussing only the special features here. The area that I have discussed now previously, that should be there in your note. Whenever you are writing a note or an answer on ACE inhibitors, all the areas which I have discussed in the previous slides should be there. This is only additional thing that you can actually add for your to make your answers more impressive. So captopril, it has got good oral absorption, penetration in the brain is poor, the food interferes with its absorption. It is partly metabolized and partly excreted unchanged in urine. The T half is 2 hours, and therefore, and the action lasts for only 6 to 12 hours. So it may require 2-time dosing. Okay, that is captopril. Now, enalapril is a prodrug. So it is converted to active form enalaprilate in the liver. The advantages, there are some advantages of enalapril over captopril. This is very important. This you have to write. That is, it is more potent than captopril. The absorption is not affected by food. So we saw that in the case of captopril, absorption was affected by food. So we have to keep a spacing between the food and captopril administration. However, in case of enalapril, it is not affected. So there is no requirement of any spacing. The onset of action of enalapril is slower because it is a prodrug. So it takes some time to get converted into the active metabolite. So the onset of action is somewhat slower. So it causes less chance of first dose hypotension. So we saw that as an ADR, the first dose hypotension was seen. So this is less in the case of enalapril. It also has got long duration of action. So only once daily dose is enough. And the other ADRs like rashes and dysgeusia are also less frequent than captopril. So you can see that it is more potent. The ADRs are less, especially the first dose hypotension, rashes and dysgeusia. And it's also got a long duration of action. So the patient has to take only one dose per day. The others are lisinopril, perindopril, and ramipril. Of this, you can see lisinopril is not a prodrug. The others are prodrugs. So among the ACE inhibitors, only two drugs are there which are not prodrugs, which are those captopril and lisinopril. So all these are having slow onset of action and long duration of action. Okay, all these three are having, and hence they require only a single dose. And all these, because of their slow action, they are having relatively less first dose hypotension. That's the only three things that you have to remember, that they are having slow onset of action, they are having long duration of action, they require a single dose, and the first dose hypotension is comparatively less in these cases as compared to captopril. Okay, so with that, we finish the ACE inhibitors. Now you can get a short note on ACE inhibitors. When you can clearly write the slides the same way I have presented to you. But sometimes you can get a short neuron captopril. So in that case, you don't write only the one slide that I had shown you. You will write the entire thing. That is captopril. It is an AC inhibitor. Then you will write the mechanism of action of AC inhibitor. You will write the actions. Then you will write the ADRs. Okay. And similarly for enalapril also, if it is given as a short note, you have to write it is an AC inhibitor, then you will write the mechanism of action, you will write the actions, the uses, ADR, and then you will write the special features or of enalapril. Because most of the times what you students usually do is that when they get a short note on one single drug, they will write only one slide that was shown. That is not the way you have to write. The common things which are there for the class of drugs should be written, and then only the special features should be written. That is why you end up having nothing when you get a note of 10 marks. You say that I have written everything, but end up with nothing. So this is the way you have to write. You have to keep it in mind that it is with a single drug, you will write everything that is common to the class of drug, that is mechanism of action, actions, uses, and ADR, and then write the special features of that particular drug. Okay, now we'll shift on to angiotensin receptor blockers, abbreviated as ARBs. So if you have understood AC inhibitors, the ARBs will be very easy because the uses, ADR, everything is more or less similar to that of AC inhibitors. So the first the examples, losartan, that was the first drug that was developed. It is the prototype drug. The others are candesartan, irbesartan, valsartan, telmisartan, olmesartan. So at least remember a few examples from this category. So this drug was developed as an alternative to AC inhibitors. And now they have become more popular than AC inhibitors. We will be seeing why they are more popular in the coming slides. So what is the mechanism of action? I think already I have told you previously they are blockers or they are competitive antagonists at the AT1 receptor. So I already told you angiotensin 2 is producing its effects by acting on the AT1 receptors. Now that is being blocked by these drugs. They are the competitive antagonists. So what will happen? It will block the actions of angiotensin 2. So again, you will repeat the same thing. That is, there is vasodilatation of the arterioles, there is a decrease in the BP, there is a decrease in the aldosterone production and decrease in the sodium and water retention. All this will decrease the BP, and they will also reverse the cardiac and vascular hypertrophy and remodeling. We are not mentioning the bradykinin here. Why? Because bradykinin production degradation was by the AC enzyme. That is having nothing to do here. This drug is only blocking the receptor of the angiotensin 2. Now, what are the adverse effects? The adverse effects are hypotension, hyperkalemia, angioedema, headache, dizziness, nausea, and it is all teratogenic. So you are seeing some of the effects that you already saw in the AC inhibitors. They are not here. That is the cough. Cough is not there in the case of ARB. So that is a very, very significant thing that has to be noted, that cough is not there in ARB. Again, you don't see other ADRs like dysgeusia, acute renal failure, proteinemia. All these things are not there in the case of ARB. So you can see that comparatively, the ARBs are having less adverse effects as compared to AC inhibitors. That is one reason why they have become more popular than AC inhibitors. The uses. The uses, it is the same one, that is hypertension, congestive heart failure, myocardial infarction, and provide prophylaxis in high cardiovascular risk subjects and diabetic nephropathy. This is not being used in scleroderma like the ACE inhibitors. Now we'll see what are the advantages of ARBs over ACE inhibitors. So they do not cause, they do not interfere with the bradykinin degradation. And hence, there is no incidence of cough with their use. This is very, very important. Other ADRs like dysgeusia occur less with the use of ARBs. Then they result in more complete blockade of angiotensin 2 action. So I think previously only I have told you that they are completely blocking the angiotensin 2 actions, whereas AC inhibitors are not completely blocking the angiotensin 2 action. So they are more potent than AC inhibitors. Now we'll look at the special features of individual ARBs. First one is losartan. So this is having a good oral absorption, not affected by food, but its oral bioavailability is somewhat low because of high first pass metabolism. It is metabolized in the liver to an active metabolite called as E3174, which is more potent competitive antagonist on the AT1 receptor. So this drug is antagonizing and its metabolite is even more potent than the drug itself. The T-half of losartan is 2 hours, but the action of the metabolite, it is like almost 6 to 9 hours. That is why this metabolite is the one which is making losartan longer acting. Then this is a comparison of other drugs. You can see candesartan, irbesartan, valsartan, olmesartan, telmisartan. Of this, olmesartan is the drug which is a prodrug. The others you can see are almost similar to losartan. Some are having higher affinity to AT1 receptors like candesartan. And the most of them are excreted in the bile and the urine. And you can see only irbesartan, which is excreted in the bile. All of them are almost having very long T-half, like 8 to 12 hours, almost at an average for everybody. And telmisartan, you can see it is having a T-half of 24 hours. So that is a very long-acting drug, telmisartan. So this is just the difference in their pharmacokinetics. So this you can remember as a tabular column itself. So once again, the important questions from this topic are: write examples, mechanism of action, actions, uses, ADR of AC inhibitors. Write examples, mechanism of action, action, uses, ADRs of ARBs. Separately also, if the AC inhibitor like captopril or enalapril is asked, or even losartan is asked, you have to write the entire thing about that particular class, and then you will mention about the that particular drug, the special features of that particular drug. So thank you.